anointed now, son, by the presence of the King. Oh, you fill my mouth with laughter. Oh, you cause my heart to sing. My feet are set to dancing by the presence of the King. King of glory, King of the ages, King of glory, Christ Jesus the eternal Word, King of glory, King of the ages, Christ Jesus the eternal Word. Oh, you fill my mouth with laughter. Oh, you cause my heart to sing. Oh, you set my feet to dancing by the presence of the King, King of glory, King of the ages. Hosanna, sing. Hosanna, Hosanna to the King of glory, King of the ages, Lord Jesus, eternal Word. Oh, you fill my mouth with laughter. Woo! Oh, you fill my mouth with laughter, and you caused my heart to sing. Lord, you set my feet to dancing with the presence of the King, King of glory, King of the ages, Christ Jesus, the eternal Word. Oh, King of glory, oh, King of the ages, Christ Jesus, eternal Word. Oh, you fill my mouth with laughter. Oh, you cause my heart to sing. Oh, you set my feet to dancing with the presence of the King, King of glory, King of the ages, Christ Jesus, eternal Word. King of glory, King of the ages, Christ Jesus, eternal Word. Oh, you fill my mouth with laughter, and you cause my heart to sing. Lord, you set my feet to dance with the presence of the King, King of glory, King of the ages, Christ Jesus, eternal Word. King of glory, King of the ages, Christ Jesus, eternal Word. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. King of glory, King of the ages, Christ Jesus, eternal Word. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Praise the
name of the living God. Hallelujah. Sikora satarane shekirimana. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, you fill my mouth with laughter. And you cause my heart to sing. Oh, you set my feet to dancing with the presence of the King. The King of glory, King of the ages, Christ Jesus, eternal Word. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Mama kada eshikuni ikarabahate. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ha 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 ha. Hallelujah. Well, tonight we just want to teach you about how to be sensitive to the voice of the Lord. Want to teach you how to present yourself to Him in such a way that He can stir you. Ha ha ha. With the riches of His presence. He can stir you with praise. I mean, even at midnight, you can't sleep. You're just like, oh, blessed is your name. God. You're just so stirred. You know, I mean, praise God for those who just, you know, go ahead and just lift up their voice and begin to sing when they're not stirred. But, I mean, there's a far better place to live. But let me just tell you something. And Father's got this for everyone. What you're going to have to do is you're going to have to begin to cut off the things that have occupied your emotions and your passions and your feelings. You just got to say no to them. You can't yield your members to all that stuff. Just let your heart become so virtuous to the Lord. Let your emotions become so virtuous to Him. You won't be able to sit there and watch murder movies, and you won't be able to sit there and watch things that belong to sin and iniquity. You won't be able to stand to hear people even talking bad about someone else. You won't be able to stand the spirits. They become just so disturbing to you. It's like a nightmare. And in that place, just walking it out with the Lord, just enjoying Him, letting God stir you with all kinds of holy emotions, and just not allowing unholy emotions. It's not allowing them. Not allowing sorrow and sadness. Sorrow and sadness are thieves that come to rob you of your joy. Worry and concern and torment, the thieves that come to rob you of your rest in Christ Jesus. Condemnation and shame and guilt, the thieves that come to rob you of your peace. All the strife and various different dimensions of hate that are spring up as divisions and evil speakings and evil surmisings. See, thieves, they come to rob you of love. And Father wants you and I to just learn how to stay over here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's why more people got to learn how to dance a little bit more. You got to learn. And somebody said, what are you talking about? Well, when you start all of a sudden having a lot of things come on you and overwhelm you, you need to just recognize that you're in the wrong spot. You're pretending the wrong things. You're in the wrong place. You need to just turn your heart towards heaven. No man will save himself or help himself or save another or help another through the arm of their own human ability by all their efforts. All that's going to do is just, it's going to manifest in your life as the sorrow and the sadness and the heaviness and the complaint and, oh, I just can't go on. It's too hard. It's too much. I mean, you expect too much of me. What a terrible place to live. I would hate to live that life. That's not life. That's dead while you live. You know what I'm saying? Father wants to fill you with joy. He wants to fill you with a river, hallelujah, of inspiration. All you got to do today is decide that you're not going to live your own life. You're going to live his life. All I got to do to decide today is that you're not going to live according to your own will, your own self-interest, but you're going to live to do the Father's will. And consecrate yourself there into, and everything will change. You'll get blessed from here on out. I want you to be able to go to bed tonight just so excited about God's love for you, so overwhelmed about the things that he's doing and wants to do with your life, that you just begin to whisper to him, talk to him, say, Father, I just thank you that you make my heart so sensitive to you. You cause my ears to hear you. One of the things Ann and I do every morning is just begin to talk to the Lord. Say, Lord, make us so sensitive to your leadings, Lord. We don't want to spend another day ignoring you. We're so caught up in our own stuff. You know, we've got their big, long list. Would you burn your list? Burn the list. Oh, I got to do this. I got to do that. You ain't doing anything. You got to die and stand before the judgment seat of Christ. That's what you got to do. Somebody said, I got to pay my bills. Not really. No, because if you learn how to walk with God, he'll pay your bills for you. Somebody said, well, that doesn't sound like responsibility. It's very responsible. It's what God said to do. Take no thought. Oh, but if I don't take thought, then who's going to take care? Exactly. We want to see that get a change. We want to see it get a change. I want you to confront your fear. I want you to confront your unbelief. Because it's a prison, and the prison will lock you in with every year that goes by that you allow it to exist in your life. It's like an elevator that keeps sinking down deeper into a deeper, darker pit of a dungeon, all the way down to hell. So today, to say, you know what? With total abandonment, I surrender to Jesus Christ. I'm going to live now. I got all that I need to live by. I have his blood for drink. I have his flesh for meat. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God made my body the dairy house of the Holy Ghost. I'm sure the Holy Spirit, he can do anything. He can do anything. He can do anything. There is nothing beyond his power. There is nothing beyond his strength. There is no provision too great for him. He provides for all of the birds and all of the beasts of the field and all the fish that swim in the sea and all the creatures that crawl upon the earth. And he can't provide for you? We want to get you out of that doubt and unbelief here today. We want you to get out, but you can't step out of it till with total abandonment you begin to offer yourself to the Lord. You know, this morning I was talking about how that sometimes, you know, people, they think, well, we're not going to go to church. It's going to cost us. We're going to have to give in the offering. You know what? You're not going to show up to the meeting when your life is at risk. And we're not too far from that, people. We're not too far from that. And there's many people in different places of the earth that already live in that. That you show up to the meeting, your very life is at risk. Not just some offering, some what? Some, you know, what? Some $1,000 that's going to be worth nothing in the streets tomorrow. You hearing me? Then who are you going to trust? Huh? When all your money is good for, is if you even have any, is to warm your, is to, as starter. A starter, because you couldn't warm yourself by it, flash to buy too quick. What are you going to do then? Yeah, your heart's wrapped up in mammon. You can't be released. That's why you're all frustrated, you know, and sad. He was so full of sorrow because they hanging on to their own life. You just go in with total abandonment. Just start living for Jesus. And then when you do, and those stuff, those different things come at you to try to oppress you, you just like, they're enemies. And you recognize them right off. So you just start dancing with the Lord and praising him because you're just so blessed that you freed from that. I once was in that prison. I know the prison. I was once lost in that realm. Hallelujah. And I surrendered to the Lord one day and said, Father, You take better care of me than I could ever take care of myself. Could you fix it? Thank you. Come on, just a little harder, and it'll work. Not really. If you just pray in the Holy Ghost, it'll work. Harastikirineya. Bendolomosikingrasapakierineishi. Hallelujah. Brong down Jesus. Hallelujah. Pressiponia. Hande Keto Bongje Keto Po Irobosheo Pona. Come on, man. Come on, man. Just start over. Just hit the reset button. In God. Just hit return unto your first love. That's hitting the reset button. Just take everything you have and put it on an altar and say, Lord, none of this means anything to me. And I want to prove it to you. I want to offer it up to you as a sacrifice. Hallelujah. That's one of the greatest promotions you can have in the kingdom of God. I know this. I've done it. People look at me and they say, oh, you have some kind of like special anointing. No, I have a whole surrender, heart of surrender to the Lord. I finally came to a place and said, Lord, I believe that you can be trusted. Huh? And that's what you're working on right now, just believing that he can be trusted. Somebody said, don't say that to me. I'm going to tell you that because when you begin to step over into that realm, faith will be released in you, and whatever you say will happen. Hallelujah. Bakadimonjayapa. So I'm standing at the crossroads of holding on, preserving my own life. But what happens when you die? How are you going to preserve your... Can you just think a little bit ahead from where you're at right now? When you breathe out your last breath, how are you going to pay for your access into heaven? How are you going to instruct the angel as to where to take you? Huh? And then who are you going to be dependent upon for a house to stay in then? Huh? Who's going to clothe you and feed you? What, you got a job all lined up in the glory? Huh? So you can continue on with your business and be occupied by whatever it is you feel about your life now? Because how is it that you live one way now and live another way then? Because that's not what the Bible says. As you die, so shall you be eternally. As the tree falls, there it lies. It doesn't move. It's time for you to get saved now. It's time for you to start living in heaven now. It's time for you to start living in faith now. Abraham could have had anything he wanted. He said, no, I'm seeking a kingdom whose builder, maker is God. I don't care nothing about all this stuff anyways. All it is burdensome for the camel's back. God gave it to me, so I'm going to steward it, but don't mean nothing to me. Hallelujah. All that cattle out there don't mean anything to me. Hallelujah. God showed up one day, said, I am El Shaddai, God Almighty. I am your shield. In other words, I am your provider, your benefactor, your suzerain. Hallelujah. I'm Brum Shataya. Hallelujah. And I am your exceeding great reward. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Walk before me and be perfect. And see, the reality of it is I know that Father's no respect of persons, that he just feels that way about any person who's willing to have a relationship with him. And I said, I want that too, Father. Thank you. I take that too. I receive that right now for me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And then it gets scary. He said, you do. Then come out from among them. Follow me into a place you do not know where you're going. Well, time out. Does that mean I have to leave my family? Does that mean I have to leave the job? Does that mean I have to pull the kids out of school? Huh? Does that mean we got to go someplace we don't know where we've been because this is where we've always lived? Yeah, that's exactly what it means. Well, here, let me think a couple of more days about this so I can really be sure. And the couple of days to turn into a couple of months, a couple of months turn into a couple of years, and then your life is over. And this is where people are stuck. You can trust him. You can trust him. And what's going to happen in the very near future, you're going to have to trust him with your whole life. Because you're not going to have the security of a police station. You're not going to have the security of a fire department. You're not going to have the security of all the things that you come to trust in. You don't even realize how much you trust in them. Huh? Security systems. People got bells and whistles that go off. I mean, flag and a light goes off at the White House if somebody turns the doorknob on some people's houses. You know what I'm saying? Police come out of the woodwork. I mean, they got the military lined up to come as well. Well, when you walk with the Lord, you don't need none of that nonsense. Hallelujah. You can be seated. I was feeling a little, I've been pushing my body quite a bit, and praise God for his grace. And so I was feeling like some kind of sickness coming on me, and I don't allow sickness. I don't have sickness. Somebody said, how is it you don't allow sickness? I'll do what I did. I start dancing, shouting, praising God. Hallelujah. Pokorada, siperenekia. Sit back and not hindered for nothing. You can be hindered. And especially when I feel something coming on me, man, I'm telling you right now, and no way. Living in divine health. Do the same thing with finances. We do the same thing with finances. Father's talking to us about a bigger budget. And you know how you step into a bigger budget? God doesn't deposit in your bank account. You step into a bigger budget by walking out into the realms of faith and just doing what God said. Because you can't calculate what God wants to do through you. You can't manage it. If you got to sit around and figure out how you're going to do it, you will always be stuck in the realm of what your own arm of flesh can provide for you. And the Lord said, cursed is every man who trusts in the arm of flesh. And you better listen up. Yeah, listen, I'm telling you, one day I took this personal. I said, Lord, am I trusting in the arm of flesh? I said, Father, I want you to just take everything and remove it from out of my life that I've gotten from myself. And anything, Lord, that I put my trust in that doesn't come from you, I don't want it anymore from this day forward. And I want you to just come and follow me because I'm following the Holy Ghost. I'm talking to you about how to be sensitive to the leading of the Holy Ghost so that you don't spend your all day ignoring him. He'll fill you up with joy. He'll fill you up with gladness. He'll make you sensitive to divine direction. He'll lead you to the places that you need to go. He'll show you the people that are willing to hear and receive the gospel. He'll show you great things concerning what he's purposed to do with your life here and in the ages. Hallelujah. People, we want you to begin to lay up in store for yourself where moth cannot destroy or rust cannot corrupt and where thieves cannot break through and steal. We want you to begin to sow your life, your affections, your emotions. This is far more than your money. It's far more than your money. But people, if you locked up in prison about money, you make it about dollar bills, people, I'm going to tell you right now, you haven't even passed test number one yet. You're not even past test number one yet. Because, listen, you got to understand, you were taught by your parents what to do and by society, not by God. Do you understand that? That ain't going to get you nowhere. And then they come along to you and they preach to you their doctrines and they're very forceful with their doctrines. Huh? Parents and advisors and, you know, peers are very forceful with their doctrines about how you got to bow down and serve money. And you buy in on that. Huh? Then we tell you, no, you got to get rid of your money. You need to burn it. Somebody says, what do you mean by that? Just come make a whole burnt offering out of it. It's like Pastor Pedro Ibarra says. He says, people want to know what's going on with the finances. Just tell them that went on the altar in a fire and then went up in smoke. It's a whole burnt offering. Hallelujah. And now I'll tell you right now, and he says, oh, no, the church just wants it. No. If you feel that way, just go give it to the poor. Just do what Jesus said, go give it to the poor. Just go leave out of here tonight. Consecrate thanks to the Lord tomorrow. Go tomorrow morning, open up your bank account, and pour it out, and go give it to the poor. And I would suggest not to the street people, but to the little kids in the city, little children in the city who aren't eating properly. Just do it. And you'll have riches in heaven. And you'll have a breakthrough in your life. I guarantee you, when you begin to sow it into the ministry, in a vision for the future, you can actually participate with things that God will be doing through the church. Should the Lord not delay his coming, as it were, should the Lord yet tarry, as it were, and not come,
for less than 200 years from now. You can be building things that will last, and ministry be going on for 200 years from now, instead of the tax collector owning just about everything you got. Huh? Or somebody taking whatever it is that you spent your life laboring for and going out and spending it at Las Vegas for one night. Or even worse than that. Worse than that. All of a sudden one day this is certain. One day you wake up and it's not worth anything. This is certain. And so I'm going to minister to you tonight some out of Acts chapter 4 is what the Lord laid upon my heart. In Acts chapter 4 and verse 33, just want to begin here. It is just wonderful to be drunk in the Holy Ghost. Somebody said, how do you get healed? How do you live in divine health? I get drunk in the Holy Ghost. It's medicine. Divine medicine. Hallelujah. Somebody said, how is it that the provision comes for you like that? I just get drunk in the Holy Ghost. I get carried away worshiping the Lord. Just tell him I don't care about nothing anyways but him. I don't care about nothing but you, Lord. Nothing matters to me. House don't matter to me. Pillow don't matter to me. Shower don't matter to me. I'm thankful for it. A lot of the other people are thankful for me having a shower. Because I get real gamey quick. They don't mean nothing. I'm sold out to Jesus. I'm a sojourner and a pilgrim. All I want to do, people don't get it. Everything I've ventured out ever to do has all been about seeing the things that a heavenly vision that has been planted and implanted in my heart by the Spirit of the Lord come to pass. That's it. All I'm interested in is finding stewards that will steward it. I'm looking for people who've dealt with selfishness and don't allow it. I look at people, when I see people got self-interest in their life and they being driven by their own purposes and I see pride rise up in them, I tell you, I'm scared of those people because I'm afraid they're going to just destroy themselves. Huh? And I want to help folks. I want to help them understand, don't allow that stuff in your spirit. Don't allow those things in your life. Look, humility and meekness. I love it to say it, lowliness and meekness. Oh, Shabbat. Oh, God, Ashiyatabaya. These are the glorious attributes, the splendor of heaven. That's what Jesus said he was. He said, come learn of me. I'm meek and lowly. Lowly is a great synonym for humility. Lowliness. Not high-mindedness, but lowliness. Oh, God, I'm just so thankful. I don't know anything but by you. I'm not sufficient of myself. You're my sufficiency. I'm not going to be able to make it. I can't do it without you. I know I can't do anything that matters or that's important or that counts. All it's going to be, all I can do are things that will matter in an earthly realm. Serve my own self-interest and bring value and meaning to my own earthly purpose. When it comes to something that's real, that's heavenly, that's eternal, none of us can do anything without him. And I don't want to live for the temporal. Why would I want to live for the temporal? I don't walk by sight. I'm not walking by my own earthly perception. I walk by faith. I'm walking in the Word of God. I mean, the Word became flesh and saved me. It delivered me from an eternity called hell. People just don't even believe it. Not really. They don't believe that God's wrath abides upon sin. Otherwise, they'd be fasting and praying for their family members that are lost. They'd be telling them, listen, your time's running out. The time clock, the hourglass of your life is about vanished away. You're going to spend eternity in a place called hell. Because people have been indoctrinated by the atmosphere. They've come under the influence of humanism and they've come under the influences of the doctrines of men. And when it gets you one place, it's got you every place. And you're entangled by it. You're entangled by it. You hear the good word of God and you want to run there, but you've got all these attachments. You're entangled. You're entangled. Your feet are all, as one brother said in a song, all your feet are all tangled in the thorns. The thorns have got you. And you want to serve God. You want to walk with him, but you haven't been willing with total abandonment to throw it all in on him. The Lord's called us, and it's essential. He's called us to forsake family and houses and a house and land and everything for him, for the kingdom and for his name's sake. And when we're willing to do that, he says he gives hundredfold in this life and in the life to come. Because what's going to happen is what he gives to us is not going to be about ourselves. It's going to be about the kingdom, you see. He wants us to get rid of everything about self-interest that will entangle us and the cares of this life that will cause us to labor all of our lifetime for that which is temporal and that which cannot profit anything. He wants us with total abandonment to throw in on everything. Throw it in to a place of total abandonment and sacrifice unto him so that he can begin to bless us for the kingdom's sake. Hallelujah. 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 What God will do with your life. People, fathers made room for you to where that you can live in a place where nothing is impossible. Where the boundless, limitless opportunities of the things of the Spirit. This isn't a fairy tale. Don't sit there and look at me like I'm speaking another fairy tale. You're just going to go live your life like you've been living it. Oh, that was a real good sermon, but I'm going to tell you right now, you go with that, I'm going to hang on what little I got. Huh? Bird in the hand's better than two in the bush. Bird, my provision for myself is better than a hope in heaven. Come on now, let me just get over in your space. Let me get over in the things that have imprisoned you, entangled you. Let me show you what's kept you from being sensitive to the Holy Ghost because you're so overwhelmed with earthly concerns. You can't be sensitive to the Holy Ghost when you're overwhelmed with earthly concerns. Praise God for his grace and his mercy. He just keeps dealing with us and working with us and ministering to us. Hallelujah. Saying, no, you can't live your life. I want to bless you. Oh, God, I want you to bless me. Well, I would like to bless you. Oh, Lord, please bless me. Oh, I'm trying. You're going to have to purify yourself from these things so that you'll be prepared unto every good work and meet for the master's use, able to be used by God. Huh? Hello. 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 You know, Jesus said, I write these things unto you that your joy may be full. Hallelujah. And if you don't live in them, you're not going to have fullness of joy. You're going to have fullness of sorrow. You have a little spurt of joy every once in a while, about as much as would come, as it were, out of a garden hose. High squirt gun. Maybe super soaker. Super soaker Christianity. Then Father said, I got a river of glory for you. Got a dobra sutidea. Got a monserana exio too. I know where the riches are. I know where the treasure chest of heaven is. I know where all the wealth is at. I know where the healing is for my body. I know where the provision is for my soul. I know where the redemption is for my life. I know where all that I have need of is. I know I have a shepherd who takes good care of me, who watches over me. Hallelujah. He's got a very watchful eye. He's got a very watchful eye. And not just say, well, I don't know where he's at right now. He's missing, but I'm sure he'll turn up somewhere. Probably doesn't do that. That'd be lazy, uncaring. Father's got a watchful eye. He wants to provide for us. He wants to take care of us. But here he's reaching out to take care of us, and we're running over to earthly things and being satisfied and feeling secure and feeling like now we're safe with our arms all wrapped around our stuff, our earthly stuff. And he's like over here with his arms stretched out saying, hey, where are the hugs? And we're over there hugging our stuff. Well, I'll get to you on Sunday morning. Right now I'm hugging my stuff. So everybody all gets sensitive to the things of the Spirit on Sunday morning. No, you don't. No, you don't. Because you don't turn God off on and off like that. He's a good God, and he'll bless you, and he'll cause his loving kindness to be experienced by you. He fills my mouth with laughter. He makes my heart to sing, sets my feet to dancing in the presence of the King of glory, the King of the ages. Whew. Hallelujah. Christ Jesus, the eternal word. Can you get that one. Just work on that for us. Work on that. I mean, I love songs from heaven. Those songs are of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Those songs are the Spirit. Hallelujah. Prokasateya. I just feel like dancing, man. I feel like dancing. Hallelujah. Ha, re, shipoya. Hallelujah. Somebody says, my goodness. One guy came to me one time, one preacher came to me and says, it's unseemly for a pastor to dance like you dance. You're not supposed to do that. You're supposed to be a leader. I said, so what does that look like? Show me what a leader looks like, please. Instruct me. Am I supposed to look like and act like you, and then I'm going to be a good example? I'm sorry. In his presence, he sets my feet to dancing. You know, some ministers came to me and they told me that the first time. I said, okay, well, Lord, if you don't want me to dance, I mean, I wish you wouldn't have written all that in the scripture about dancing. And I wish you weren't inspiring me, getting me. I mean, I'm telling you right now, something happens to me. I just like, I'm gone. And then that night, I said, Lord, I'll just submit all this to you because I want to honor you. I don't want in any way dishonor you. And all these guys think that this is just. I said to the one man of God, I said, are you telling me this is what the Lord says? And he said, no, I'm just consider it. Maybe you should just like think about hopping because you just are wild. You know, man, I move. I mean, you know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. I can't hop. I'd run out of breath inside of 2 seconds. But when I start moving in the things of the Spirit, man, I tell you, I got energy. I feel like I can run 1,000 miles. Hallelujah. Jump all the way to heaven. Leap all the way to heaven. And that night, the Lord gave me a dream. And in the dream, I saw the seraphims in the Holy of Holies, worshiping the Father. And that night, I understood what it meant that with two wings, they do fly. And they aren't just hovering. It was beautiful to dance. It was beautiful. The glorious movements. And I tell you, I got liberated that night. Hallelujah. I told everybody I could find, hey, listen, man, I tell you right now, let me show you what happens in the Holies of Holies. So the Lord came and visited me. And I just appreciate very much you telling me to quit dancing here. I'm going to show you what happened. Just begin to rejoice in the Lord. It isn't about a show. It isn't about trying to show how spiritual you are, trying to get somebody to value you more because you now do something you couldn't do before. It's about you and the Lord. It's about your relationship with Him. It's about with total abandonment serving Him. It's about having a heavenly vision and moving into a realm in God where that you're 24 hours a day moving in the things of the Spirit. How many of you think about it? How many of you move so many hours of the day under the mandate of doing what man tells you you got to do and declaring it the way he says you've got to speak it? Especially some of you school teachers, you're under the prince and the power of the air if you're not careful. Because the spirit of darkness wrote the school curriculum. And nothing in there anymore. My grandmother was a school teacher. Their primary textbook was the Bible. She was a school teacher, public school teacher in Mottersville, Michigan. One of their primary textbooks was the Bible because they did history there. Huh? They did reading there. They did, of course, math and, you know, and other things. But that's the way the school system used to be set up in America. The Bible and prayer was central. Even when I was a little guy, when I first went into school in 1964, you still prayed before the class began. And that was just a public secular school on the East Coast. That wasn't that many years ago. It's the curriculum now and the school system now is completely designed and written by the prince and the power of air, the God of this world. and you speaking out his doctrines all day long, and you're living as a slave to him on so many levels, dear people, you're going to have to break free of that nonsense and start beginning to risk your life for the King of Kings. I mean, wouldn't it be a wonderful thing? How many school teachers do we have here in the place today? Raise your hand tonight. How many school teachers here tonight? There's a few school teachers. Wouldn't it be amazing tomorrow if you announced at every class, I want all of you to realize that the wrath of God abides on sin. What a breakthrough. You'll find out who you serve. You'll find out how much you're threatened and how much you're intimidated by the forces of hell. And how much you hold on to your life, and you will not, refuse to speak his word. Huh? I pray somebody gets themselves some Holy Ghost guts. I pray somebody gets themselves some true strength of the Lord and boldness to stand up for what's right. Listen, I'm telling you right now, it is the number one question that needs to be presented to all Americans. They don't know this. They do not know that the wrath of God abides upon sin. But it is a powerful word of deliverance. And the word of God won't turn void. And yeah, you're gonna create an uproar. Where are y'all guys going? You're gonna be back? Everybody's coming back? Okay, just wanna check. Just make sure everybody's coming back, because I haven't even started this announcements. Well, who are you gonna serve? Let's not pretend anymore. Huh? So not pretending. Where are you going to serve? You're not willing to lay down your life? You're not willing to risk your life for his name's sake? If you're not, you need to read the Bible again. You know, if people just start consistently reading the Bible, the Lord start talking to them like they never heard before in their life. It's just about that simple. And the only reason people don't read the Bible consistently is because there's not a stir in their heart. They've never had the fire of the Holy Ghost, because the fire of the Holy Ghost produces the fire of the Word. You listen to me. The movings of the Holy Ghost produces a great hunger for the Word of God. That's how God, the Holy Ghost, speaks to us. There's a lot of people go out and want to represent God. My, they'd do a much better job if they would just read their Bible more. Hallelujah. Bless their heart, they want to go out and represent God, but, you know, they'd do a much, much better job if they knew what they were talking about. And they would just start talking right out of the realms of heaven. Praise the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. And look at what all he did for you. Look what all he did for me. Though he were rich, for our sakes he became poor. But you and I are not willing to do that for him. There's something wrong with that. Don't you agree? Don't you agree with that? Don't just kind of like shake your head at me. I'm asking you a question. I'm challenging you here tonight. Though he were rich, for our sake, if the Lord Jesus had not come and laid his life down for you and me, you and I would be lost eternally without God, without hope in this world. I wonder somehow, if we've just so marginalized what he's done for us, if we somehow we've just become so overfamiliar what he's done for us and just lost his meaning. If somehow we have so been embracing all the things of this world that doubt has so captivated our thinking that we can't begin to move in faith, because to understand these things that God did for us demands that you move in faith, that you move in the faith which the Holy Ghost supplies. Then all of a sudden, that's like it happened today. It is fresh, it's meaningful, it's intense to you. Of what he did, that he came and rescued and redeemed us at a great cost to himself, at great suffering, at his own expense. And without him, you and I would be lost forever. And are we gonna, we're going to have to somehow allow God the Holy Ghost to stir us with holy emotions and holy divine compassion so we can begin to understand the value of souls around us, that unless somebody gives them the word of God, unless somebody warns them, unless somebody tells them, they're forever eternity in a place called hell, in a place called the lake of fire that burns with the wrath of God. People have got to hear it. Satan is commanded and sent forth a decree that everyone must keep their mouth shut. There's very few bold people who stand up and speak the counsel of God. Very few. People live for themselves. They're hiding in the caves. They're hiding behind the rocks. Somebody needs to be stirred as David was stirred by the Holy Ghost. I tell you, start living in this realm of the Spirit. How you start drinking of the good things of heaven. Hallelujah. Woo! You'll be so caught away in, you'll be so caught away in the good things of God and the boldness that he supplies. You'll look down and see a giant that stands 12, 15 foot tall, and he'll look real small. So I'm going to go down there and kill him. I'm going to go down. He's not going to run me down. A Shamgar that says, I'm not taking a chicken trail home no more. I'm not shutting my mouth for your sake. I'm not eating my grain. I'm stealing my own grain and then hiding and eating it in secret. I'm taking a king's highway home. It's my land. And he took a stick, a pole that he used to just move the ox forward. And that day he became the champion of Israel, delivered Israel with nothing more than a big old pole in his hand. He smashed them all. Because suddenly he said, no more am I going to be beaten down. No more and I'm going to be marginalized. No more am I going to be silenced. No more am I going to hide like a coward, holding on to what little thing I got. And Father has given all this to me as an inheritance. This afternoon I was reading Lamentation chapter 5. We have to pay to drink our own water. We have to buy our own wood to burn in the fire. Our skin is black from famine. Because of the disobedience to God. Oh, turn us, O God, and we will be turned. But you would not, for your wrath is kindled against us. Because of disobedient people. And you know, I'm not going to go into ministry today on judgment in the New Testament church. I ministered on this morning. Sometimes I look around some of you people and I think, my goodness gracious, you need to be in the meetings. You know what I'm saying? I praise God that everybody wants to go to work. But I'm going to tell you right now, what kind of work are you doing? What are you reproducing? Right. Whatever in your spirit you're reproducing in the people you're ministering to, you better be careful. Right. You better be careful. I'm going to tell you right now, you reproduce something in somebody's life, it's not what God ordained. You got judgment on your head. Don't let there be many teachers among you, for you shall receive the greater judgment. In fact, God took it another level, called it condemnation. And there's a difference between judgment and condemnation. Paul described it. He said, if we're chasing down the Lord, we're judging the Lord, that we not be condemned with the world. You listen to me. You get your spirit right or you sit down. Huh? Because I'm telling you right now, I'm sensitive to wrong things. I'm sensitive to wrong behavior. I'm sensitive to wrong spirits. I'm sensitive when people living in strife and debate. I'm sensitive when people living in doubt and unbelief. I'm sensitive when people trusting in themselves and not trusting God. Why? Because God's sensitive to it, and he points it out, and he says, you deal with it. You deal with it. You lay it out there. You deal with it. And people don't realize it, but the church, God's shepherds, is about turning people from their wickedness. God's shepherd is about seeing the people get healed. God's shepherd is not, God's shepherds don't allow the sheep to remain sick and diseased. God's shepherds show the people the difference between that which is holy and that which is profane. And that which is acceptable to God, that which is not acceptable to God. The other day I went looking for a lost calf and I just took a gun with me. One thing is, there's a good sight on it, and I can see out a long distance, and I didn't have any binoculars. And I was especially interested in some coyotes, but I'll take them out. I'm here taking out coyotes tonight, spiritual ones. Demon predators want to destroy the sheep. Want to wait till some sheep gets all isolated, feeling sorry for itself? I got you. Not staying with the herd, as it were. Not staying with the group. Huh? There's safety over here. Praise God. Get your spirit right. Get your spirit right. There's a price to pay. Do what God says to do. I guarantee you, if you obey God and do what God says for you to do, and somehow he lets you down, we'll all take up a big offering for you and restore it to you. God ain't never let the God's a faithful God. You need a little security, we'll try to back God up for you. We'll be surety for God. Amen. Praise the name of Jesus. Katori manjekia mukeataya. I want you to learn how to be led by the Holy Ghost. God, the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. He wants to show you how to make right decisions today. Keep you happy. Yes. Keep you blessed. Hallelujah. He wants to show you the good things of heaven all day long. Hallelujah. People, listen. Listen. I mean, look, don't. I want to help some of you here tonight. I'm really not interested in hearing prophecy come out of somebody. It sounds like they're crying and hysterically upset at somebody just before they start prophesying. I want you to know, I'm really not interested in hearing a word from somebody whose face is all distorted and looks like that, everybody's been blown up or about ready to die. I'm really not interested in it. I'm not interested in prayers that look like you're really agonizing. I'm really not interested. I'm interested in Holy Ghost inspired things that have an expression of a divine power and authority and joy and goodness. Now, there's intensity and passion in prayer, and I'm not speaking against that. I mean, I came in tonight and I was watching Jacqueline a little bit, and I just saw the Holy Ghost on her, and that was passionate and that was intense. Well, I'm going to tell you right now, you need to get authority and power in your voice. I don't want people to sit around and teach folks how to mourn, be chastened. Am I doing that? Do I look like that? Somebody take a movie of me. I've been watching myself. They're taking a movie of me. I've been watching myself. I mean, on video of me. I just want to. I've been watching myself. I've been doing that. Where do people learn these contortions of the face? I didn't see that on me. This agonizing. I mean, I have this cow. You put him in the chute. She thinks she's gonna die. She gets down on her knees and she goes. It is a terrible death cry. That's not the sound of the spirit. That's the sound of torment and agony and frustration. Please, people, get some joy in your voice. Get some boldness in your look. Get some confidence in the shout. Hallelujah. My. You can't, you wonder. Somebody starts supposedly moving the Holy Ghost and you think somebody's being screamed at. Wait a minute, stop. Something wrong with that. Get joy in the sound of your voice. Get joy in the sound of your praise. Get joy in the midst of your interaction. Amen. Amen. Get happy about your wife and your husband and your children and your parents and the things that are around you. Huh? Don't sit there all agonizing. That isn't God. Doesn't anybody teach you how to pray after the natural? Sit around and pray and in some kind of doubt and unbelief prayer. Let's learn how to pray. Let's get people to teach you. You let people that you can see that they moving in faith. You let them teach you how to pray the prayer of faith. Prayer of doubt and unbelief ain't gonna help nobody. That's ugly looking. Huh? People can get into works and performance. Works and performance is that what you can do out of human ability that's really really under the shadow and mandate of doubt and unbelief. What God wants is the things that are produced by his Holy Ghost that comes in the realms of faith by the Spirit. Hallelujah. If you got doubt and unbelief going on in your life, you can't teach. If you yielding your members, listen, you can only give what you've received. If you yielding your members to doubt and unbelief, how are you going to teach people to pray the prayer of faith? All you can teach them to do is to pray the prayer of doubt and unbelief, and that's looking going to look bad. Come on now. I want you to come under divine order. God wants you to come under divine order. He wants things to be changed in your life. There are evidence that you're walking with God. There are fruits that you're walking with God. God isn't on the shelf. He's not something that you get to when everything else is done. I'll get around to you, Lord, later. Oh, sorry, I missed you the past couple of weeks. Yeah, I'm going to catch up. We'll catch up. We'll have a coffee. Come on, Devo. Are you going to serve God? Are you going to worship Him? Or is He supposed to come serve you? I want you to get your spirit right tonight. I'm talking in the first person from the Lord. I could say, here is what the Lord says. I want you to get your spirit right tonight.
Amen.
But I don't know, if I just had to do that, I mean, my goodness, every sentence. Here's what the Lord says. You're supposed to be speaking as oracles of God, and that means that you're always saying what the Lord says. Isn't that a beautiful, wonderful, glorious church, huh? Everybody speaking as oracles of God. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise then. You have to quit all your jesting and foolish talking. You have to quit all the arguing and speaking doubt and complaints and murmuring. Because then your mouth is contaminated. Y'all, contaminated mouth. Huh? You ever seen somebody with a whole bunch of cold sores all over their mouth? You think, huh? Does that look good to you? No, it don't look good. Huh? Leprosy attacked people's lips, and it would eat out their gums. They wouldn't have a lip or gums. The teeth would fall out because it attacked different parts of the body. That's unclean. That don't look good. But rather, you want those words to be pleasant words. You want those lips to be beautiful, as it was described in the Songs of Solomon. You know what? Them nice rosy lips kind of thing, you know? Sweet lips. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Speaking for the sweet words of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Shtikaramande. Boshti teraneya. Hallelujah. Teraneya. Shikananeya. Hallelujah. 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 I never found anybody flowing the Holy Ghost all upset and you're trying to agonize. I mean, it's like, goodness gracious, take some glass or something, get on with the program. You know, you praise Him, you worship Him, you begin to delight in Him, you see? And as you do, the flow comes. Because, yeah, the world would oppress you. The powers of darkness and circumstances would overwhelm you and create sorrow and create within you a sense of being overwhelmed and burdened, but thanksgiving and praise begin to set your feet upon the right path and begin to open up your spirit to those things which God the Holy Ghost is doing. And suddenly you'll go from darkness to light. Suddenly you'll go from sorrow to gladness and joy. In a moment, in an instant, in twinkling of an eye, those things that seem to be too much for you to be able to handle, all of a sudden the mountain has become the molehill that it always was. Hallelujah. It just disappears before you. Hallelujah. Karasei kanam. Praise the name of the Lord. Harabo karaseya. Handele mengashya porania. Hallelujah. You know, I was asking the Lord one day, and I said, Lord, show me, you know, that place that Daniel had with you. He wasn't even baptized in the Holy Ghost. You know? Whew. He didn't even know this wonderful fellowship that we have access to. Oh, joy unspeakable and full of glory. But yet he was able to step in and be so into a realm of relationship with the Lord that he could be so sensitive to the Holy Spirit that he would know the things that were said in secret. He had wisdom and insight, the knowledge of the Lord, to where the people could recognize from the highest places of authority that the Spirit of God was in him. I said, Lord, show me about him. And the Lord took me over there and showed me how that he knelt down three times a day and he began to praise and give thanks unto the Lord. That was his prayer. He was teaching people how to, I don't know what. But they're not teaching them how to pray. Praise and thanksgiving. Prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. God says, doesn't say keep yourself frustrated praying in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Huh? He said, build yourself up in your most holy faith. Keep yourself in the love of God. Amen.
Amen.
Faith, confidence, boldness, certainty. Amen. Not agonizing, oh God, are you there? Oh God, I'll do whatever it takes. The sacrifice has been made. Christ Jesus suffered for us at Calvary that we may enter into his joy and enter into his rest. He who was rich became poor for our sake, that through his poverty we might be made rich. Wow, what a beautiful, wonderful thing the Lord has done for us. He has made me glad. Oh, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. Hallelujah. Look at what great things he's done. Oh, Ramande Ishte. Now, if he who is rich became poor for my sake, that through his poverty I might be made rich, then why am I walking around acting like I need to do something for myself? Why am I walking around acting like I need to provide for myself when he's provided for me according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus? Huh? Why would I need to think that somehow I need to be all occupied and frustrated with my own decisions when the Holy Ghost has come to lead me and give me insight? I learned a long time ago, and you know that I read one day that they wrestled the scripture to their own destruction. And I said, Lord, I never want to sit around and try to figure out what it is you said ever again. And so what happened was, many times I'd come to a verse of scripture, I wouldn't understand it. I try to understand, you know, I'd start to reason, start to try to think it through, and I just shut that down. I'd say, wait a minute, I know that that isn't the way God works. I'm not going to try to figure nothing out. I'm not trying to wrestle it, analyze it. I'm going to wait on God and let him give me wisdom and insight. I discovered a realm into being sensitive to the Lord and letting him lead me. We want to think. I mean, you and Pooh Bear, you got to get together. You know, just have yourself a thinking thing going on. Listen, it's not just, listen, make your requests known unto God.
Amen.
The Lord's real simple about it. He says, don't be worried or concerned about anything. Don't try to think it through, because then you're going to end up with what you got. You're going to try to figure it out, and all you're going to do is work yourself into a deeper ditch. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
Just make your request known unto the Lord with thanksgiving. And what he's going to do is he's going to speak to you, and you're going to know exactly what to do. Hey, it's just all I can wake up in the middle of the night or in the morning or just driving down the road or just doing whatever it is you do, and suddenly you're going to be quickened by the Holy Ghost, and you know that's exactly the answer. That's exactly what you're supposed to do. And then you get used to living this way, and it'll be so good that anytime your thinking thing starts to kick in, you realize it's a thief that's come to rob you of the insight from heaven. And now you're going to get aggressive with you. Say, you ain't going to come around here and try to figure out something for me to do with my life. I'm not going to sit here and reason out, map it all out. Triangles, circles, what ifs, pros and cons, exit strategies. Lord, I just give this thing to you, and I just thank you that you're going to lead us, and you're going to guide us, and you're going to show us what to do. Hallelujah. We begin to praise him. See, it's a trust thing. If you got problems trusting him in one area, you're going to have problems trusting him in other areas. And Father wants you to get this trust worked out in our life, no matter what it costs, because it then opens us up into a realm of great provision in God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. If he spared not his own son, but offered him up for the sins of us all, shall he not also by him freely give us all things? Well, I so happen to believe the redemption story. I so happen to believe what God did for me at Calvary through Christ Jesus. I just so happen to believe that through his poverty I was made rich. I'm good to go. I have all that I have need. I have all that I have need of. He supplies all that I have need of. In famine, I will not lack. He who trusted in themselves, I feel sorry for you. You come over to my house for dinner. Amen. Hallelujah. I will not famine. I shall not know it. See, that's why Jeremiah said, Jeremiah chapter 17, but it's brought over in the New Testament. I'm just talking about some provision and grace of God revealed in the Old Testament, which is revealed again and again and again. Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Looks like there needs to be some chairs back there. Guys, can you guys got any more chairs? I'll make sure everybody's comfortable. Everybody's got a seat. Now everybody don't have to stand like me. Ha bodo standing in Galaya. Ha romo sikina namandeya pura manaya. Hallelujah. Father wants us to discover these riches. He wants us to begin to explore this glorious realm that He's made available to us. But you don't get to start until you're willing to stand the test and evaluation of trust. You're not going to start until you're willing to respond to those things that demand abandonment unto Him. You're not going to be able to move on with God's program or provision until you're willing to with everything that is within you, make Him, as Jeremiah said, the sole object of your trust. Let me read that verse of Scripture to you before I read the one I'm going to read. Jeremiah chapter 17. Listen, people, I just want to see you. I want to see you begin to let God form you and mature you and prepare you so that you can go everywhere preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. There needs to be churches all over the Western United States. There's not Holy Ghost churches hardly really to speak of in the Western United States. Somebody was telling me, I told Tim, I think Tim's watching tonight. I said, I'm going to come up there, man, get that church, help you get that church going. He said, well, it just is a hard place. Well, you need a good church then. Oh, well, the Baptist got everything going on. The Baptist won't stand a chance against me. I'm bringing God. Amen. I'm bringing a full meal. I'm not bringing some little appetizers and say, hey, that's it. Huh?
Yes.
A couple little pieces of finger food and say, that's the feast. We're going to bring them. We're going to roll out the feast, man. We're going to pray for the sick, cast out devils, and worship God. Glory is going to come down. New definition of church is going to be. Hallelujah. Provided for those people up there in Walla Walla or whatever you call it. Yeah, I know it's not Walla Walla, but I think it's kind of like that right now. I'll be Walla Walla later. We're going to get them out of whatever it is they in. Amen. And there's places like that all over the United States of America, especially in the Western United States. And I want to see God raise you up. Begin to move in faith. You can't do these things unless you are willing to respond to God right where you're at with all the things that are going on in your life right now. Yeah. With the things that you hold dear right now, the things that you put your trust in right now, if you're not careful, if they things that are earthly and temporal, they're preventing you from the eternal. God wants you to begin to engage in the eternal. That's what the Holy Ghost is supplying. That's how we begin to not look on those things which we see and walk after those things that we would observe through our senses. But we begin to move in the Word of God, move by faith. Hallelujah. And look on those things which are unseen, that are eternal, which the Holy Ghost ministers to us. Jeremiah chapter 17, just want to read this to you real quickly. It's a very important verse of Scripture. Everybody needs to grab a hold of it. And you need to grab a hold of that personally for yourself by personal evaluation. If you judge yourself, you won't have to be judged. Amen? If you allow God the Holy Ghost to evaluate you, to say, Lord, search me, O God, know my heart, try me, know my thoughts. Very important thing. Huh? Yeah. How many of you know your own thoughts? You know how much of them are honest, pure? Huh? Lovely? Virtuous? All those things that Paul showed the church at Philippi. Hey, Fountainhead. How are you over here? You need to apply this verse of Scripture to yourself. So when we raise these girls not trusting themselves, move in faith and miracles.
Amen.
Every time they start trusting themselves, we're going to point out, don't you trust yourself, you can't do that.
No.
We're working on this one right now. She's in school. That ain't going to be going on too much longer. Good news is that she's easily distracted from her problems. And if we don't help her, it's going to come as life goes on. She'll be rooted in her problems and hard to get her out of it. That's why it's adult. That's what it means to become an adult. To become so rooted in your problems you can't get out of them. out of that thing. Let's try something different. You better be careful. You're going to get in trouble here tonight. We're going to start ministering to you directly. Look at this verse of scripture with me, please, in Jeremiah chapter 17. And let the Lord speak to you, and let him evaluate you with his word. Thus says the Lord, cursed is every man that trusts in man, and makes the arm of flesh his strength, or his provision, and whose heart departs from the Lord. So he's just saying, if you trusted in yourself and your own provision, your heart has departed from the Lord. Well, I want that personal, intimate relationship with the Lord. I don't want to depart from him in any way. I'm not going to put my trust in the arm of flesh. And plus, I don't want to be cursed. Because when God curses something, it's cursed. That's what he said. Thus saith the Lord. Oh, this is what the Lord says. Pretty radical. Isn't that not pretty radical? When I look at radical verses of scripture like this, I go, search me, O God. Know my heart. Try me. Know my thoughts. See if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. He wants to lead us. Holy Ghost come to lead us. Word of God come to try us. Come to examine us. And we got to respond to the word. It's got to be a reciprocation. Because, yeah, the Lord is going to do and work of his good pleasure in us. But at the same time, he's going to say, they that purify themselves from these things shall be prepared unto every good work and meet for the master's use. So it's both. It's God's provision for us, him doing and willing of his good pleasure in us, and us willing to participate with that and say no to the wrong and yes to the right, and allow his work and allow his provision to produce within our lives major change in the way we think and our attitudes and our behaviors and our response. And fundamentally, the very focus of that is, where is our trust? And God makes it really about our financial provision, where you're getting your food from, where you're getting your protection from your enemies from. And of course, now we've got all these false hopes created around us. They're about to be unveiled. Listen to me, people. Listen to me. I hate to tell you. America will never be the same. It's a different America, and it'll never be the same. We've already crossed the line of decision. For 45 years, the men of God have declared and said, if you'll repent, turn from your wickedness, seek God, he'll heal you, heal your land. I mean, for 45 years, since 1970, the men of God have raised up and cried out to America and pled with America to the pleadings of the Holy Ghost that the time has run out. I can remember those prophets and those ministers that I knew personally back in the 70s. They would have never known that it would have gone on, that God's grace and mercy would have extended 45 years. And not only was there not change and turning back to God, it's gotten exponentially worse. Iniquity has increased in our society on an unimaginable level. My grandmother, she read the Bible through. Her father was a preacher, Quaker preacher. They came from a long line of Quakers on that side of the family, all the way back. Quaker preachers since 1620 in America. So I guess where I get my American history from. 1620, American preachers, Quaker preachers. And she read the Bible the first time when she was 10 years old on a cover wagon trip from Tennessee to Michigan. And I was staying with her when I was going to school in West Florida. And one day I walked in and she's sitting in the living room and she's just crying. She's weeping. This is back in 1979. Forgive me, 1979. Forget that I'm that old. Okay, but 1979. And I walk in the living room, she's in there crying, sobbing. I said, she's watching this. I said, Grandma, what's wrong? She said, this world, this nation is so perverse and wicked. She's watching the news. I said, don't do this to yourself. What's wrong? She said, these commercials, this is demonic. She's just a Quaker Northern Baptist person, sobbing. I mean, what would she think now? Listen, people sit here in the church, say they're full of the Holy Ghost, and they allow stuff to go on in their lives, and they view things that the world wouldn't have viewed 100 years ago. It's the sin, deceitfulness to sin will make you calloused and hard against Holy Ghost conviction. She was sensitive to the things of the Spirit. She never knew the ways of sin. She's just a farmer from Michigan who worked hard all of her life, teaching in school and then coming home to work in the fields. I didn't know this iniquity. And the Lord says, because of iniquity, the love of many shall wax cold. Because of iniquity. Because iniquity abounding, forgive me. Because of the iniquity abounding, because iniquity's all around us. And, you know, being, it's like, it's kind of harkens back to Lot being vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked. Begins to lose his sensitivity to the anointing. Begins to lose his sensitivity to the presence of God. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Praise him. Lift your hands and praise him right now. There you go. Amen. Anna's been really encouraging Naomi to start flowing more in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Anna starts worshiping in the house and says, come on, Naomi, you need to start flowing in the Holy Ghost. Amen. There we go. That's it. There we go. Praise God. Come on, just let that bubble up out of you. Hallelujah. There you go. Woo! Hallelujah. That's a whole lot better than fussing, ain't it? Amen. And I wish everybody would work that easy. Amen. Hallelujah. I mean, that's how we minister to our children. I mean, we bought into a lie and want to teach them all this nonsense that is meaningless. It is meaningless, and it's not even it's a large part of it's not even facts. It's spin. Serving men's own interests. It's time we start ministering to our children in the things of the Spirit. Amen. And our families, and we model it for them. Get over here. In Jesus' name. Look, let's just get into the Word. Let's delight ourselves in fatness. Thus says the Lord, curses the man that trusts in man. You're a man. Are you trusting in man? Are you trusting in provision? Oh, dial 911. Please help us, Lord Jesus. The authority that Father has given us. It's going to take some work, but we're going to get her done. Look at how well Anna's doing tonight. You're just going to have to understand. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to make sure that my kids and my grandkids, of course, the kids part thing is over, they're all adults. I'm going to make sure they're listening, paying attention, and behaving properly in the meeting. And if I don't do that, how am I going to be able to guide the house of the Lord? So, he says, he shall be like, listen to this. For he shall be like the heath in the desert. Ouch. And shall not see when the good comes, but shall inhabit the parched places. That's a bummer. That ain't good. That's working hard, never getting ahead. He shall inhabit your inheritance is going to be worse than that swamp land in West Florida, Central Florida. Your real estate portion isn't going to be swampland. That would be a step up. Your inheritance is going to be a parched place in the wilderness, a salt land that cannot be inhabited. Ouch! Yeah. You can't grow nothing there. Ain't nothing to drink, nothing to eat, no shade to get under. That is like Sahara Desert stuff and worse. Okay, you got that? You understand what the problem is now? But blessed is the man who makes the Lord the sole object of his trust. He said, whose hope is in the Lord, whose confidence is in the Lord. For he should be as a tree planted by the waters and that spreads out her roots. That's the place I'm living. Hallelujah. Aha! And somebody says, oh, well, it's just too difficult to go over there. I got to give up too much. Listen, that's exactly what happens with the lost. They sit in the meeting and they think, I've got to change too much. I've got to give up too much. Listen, I watch Christians do the same thing. I've got to change too much. I've got to give up too much. It's going to cost me too much. It's just too scary. I'm not ready yet. You're never going to be ready. You better call out to God for help. Say, deliver me. Lord, I want to quit trusting in my own self. I want to start trusting in you. Blessed is the man who makes the Lord the sole object of his trust. That man in whose confidence is the Lord. For he shall be as a tree planted by the waters. It spreads out her roots by the river and shall not see when the heat comes. Hallelujah. But her leaves shall be green and shall not be careful in the year of drought. Or shall not even know or be concerned, rather, in the year of drought. In fact, won't even know there is a drought. Neither shall they cease from yielding fruit. During the Great Depression, my grandparents didn't even know about the Great Depression. They got out and milked the cows, brought in the hay, took care of the fields and the garden, and was living the same way they'd been living. Huh? Just praise, blessing and praising the Lord for the bountiful provision. Others, the Depression, well, they weren't all caught up in all that stuff. Father's even got a better provision for us. The whole world can collapse around us and come down to absolutely nothing. We won't even know about it because we're not in the system. Not in the system. I'm in another system. I'm in a heavenly commerce. Hallelujah. I'm living where the grapes are growing. Ha! Huh? I'm living where the rivers are flowing. Ha! Huh? I'm living in Canaan. In Canaan's land. In a heavenly realm. Hallelujah. Not trusting in men. Bastakaradea. Remonde. Pisti. It's hard to get people. Listen, it's hard to get people healed when the religion's all bound up in the thing. It is hard to get people saved when there's all kinds of doubt and unbelief running interference. Huh? It's hard to get people moving into the things of divine provision when they've not allowed faith to work in them, be developed, and now they're actually right in the middle of calamity. Now I want you to turn with me quickly over here to Acts chapter 4. And I want to just minister some more of the good news here. Should you be willing to hear? Bad news if you're not going to hear. Bad news if you're not going to change. Did you hear the bad news? If you're not going to change, it's bad news. It's not all good news. Somebody said, preach good news. Fine, I will, but there's going to be some bad news too. It's good news if you hearken and obey. It's bad news if you don't. Good news, you believe, saved. Bad news, you don't believe, you're damned. That's pretty big. You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. Good news, step in the kingdom of God. Bad news, you reject these things, you don't know the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. Anathema Maranatha, cursed until the coming of the Lord. Bad news. Oh, he's a bad news preacher. No, I'm good news and bad news preacher. Good news for those that believe, and a warning to all those who refuse to believe that the bad news is coming down on your head. And we want you to escape the wrath that is to come. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And it's a good thing to have good, holy fear. The fear of the Lord. Huh? If Annie starts acting up, I'll show her my belt. I'll decide to wear my belt tonight. It's no threat. It was just only a threat, and then it became a living instrument to administer discipline. And now all of a sudden it has a whole nother value and a whole nother level of respect. Those eyes get really big. I just love her so much. You're okay. In Jesus' name, help her. Acts 4:33. Can I read verse 32? And the multitude of them that believed were one heart and one soul. Neither said any of them that that the things that they possessed were their own. Can you hear that? Does that just make you sick to your stomach? Huh? Doesn't that just make you sick to your stomach?
If you don't have anything, it sounds good. But if you've got something, it sounds bad. Hallelujah. It's another dimension. You have to, this is a response to being caught up into a heavenly realm. This isn't something that can be mandated through socialism. Because then there's somebody just going to profit and everybody else going to starve. Are you listening to me? This is something that comes as a result of a great moving of God, where every man begins to move in a common purpose, in a common interest, as the army of the Lord, as the household of faith, as the community of the people of God. It's a totally different realm. It's an earmark of revival, though. Huh? The provision of God isn't limited as we would try to limit it. He hasn't just confined that which he's going to do to the certain realms that men have represented. The Father has graciously, by divine provision, given us everything that we need so that we don't have to live under the pressure of a culture mandated to us by the governments of men when we are to be living under the government of Christ Jesus. But you cannot create that out of a human effort, out of a human mandate, or out of a human understanding. But it is something that everyone must begin to participate with as they respond to the Holy Ghost and begin to move in faith and begin to step out and trust God as the Lord ministers to them at each point of trust, at each point of challenge in your life. Put your hand over her mouth. That'll help her. Get instructions while we're doing this. Bring that will into subjection. Hear what the Lord Jesus is saying to you. Hear what the Lord is crying out and petitioning you to do. Somebody said, well, Pastor, tell me, where do I begin? Begin to cry out to the Father, because he wants to provide a grace, an ability for you to be able to do these things. He's given to us everything that we have need of. All we've got to do is ask him. You know, the love is something that we continue to say, Lord, fill me. He's filled us with his love. He's poured his love into us. But we'll find challenges and situations that we'll come up against in our daily lives that we just need. We recognize that we're responding not out of love, but now all of a sudden there's, you know, other self-interest response. But we stop. We say, Holy Spirit, fill me with your love for this situation. Fill me with faith. Fill me with divine ability. Fill me with your joy. Fill me with your peace. In the same way, we ask Father to fill us and provide for us an understanding of how to move in these things that he's purposed for the church and the community of the church to live and function in this realm of divine glory, to have our citizenship in heaven, to have our conversation in heaven, to have our faith in the realms of heaven, to be seated in the realm of heaven, to walk in that authority of heaven. People, God is calling out to us to separate ourselves from the world and all that the world system would impose upon us. Not go live out in a cave, not go move out in some place of isolation. It's talking about a separation of a heart and our desires and our passions. Separation of our lives in him, where we look into him for all that he has for us. And we liberally and generously take that which he gives to us and provides us with. And we lay it at the apostles' feet. We lay it at the ministry's feet. We lay it at his feet for the purposes of the kingdom. I mean, just think about it. What if you were begin to be a part of a whole cultural shift where all of a sudden now business serves ministry instead of ministry serving business? Where that you literally, all your mind thinking is I'm going to go to work today singularly to see finances created for the kingdom of God, to plant churches, to take care of the ministry, to reach the lost, to deal with so many of the multitudes of millions upon millions of orphans out there that have properly taken care of. Every one of them be reached for the kingdom. If we as the church provided another means for all of the people who now their only option, as it seems, is to go get an abortion, and we provided another means of care for those children and for the mother that is in despair and distress, who has no husband, who has no money, and the list goes on, and is so under the guilt and under the shame and under the pressure and don't know what they're going to do and can't even provide for themselves, and here comes, and we've got provision for them to take care of. My goodness! We want to go out and we want to go out and try to, what alternatives are we going to present when we go out with our protest, as it were? When we're not willing to step over into a miraculous realm of wisdom and insight and provision and divine ability that only God can give, and God will only give it to those people who with total abandonment will trust Him. With total abandonment, surrender all that they have, forsake all that they have, come follow Him. This is the precipice. This is the moment of decision. This is the crossroads that we all face. And listen, the only way we're going to be able to do this right, cry out, God, Father, strengthen me, help me. Oh, God, I want to be able to see this. I want to be able to feel this. I want to be able to know this. I want to be able to understand this. Oh, Lord, help my unbelief. Provide this grace, oh, God. Father, I want to move with You. I want to flow with You. I want to be all about the kingdom. I want to be all about the heavenly vision. I want to be all about Your divine purposes. I want to be all about that which lasts for eternity. I want to be all about that that brings glory and honor to Your name. That's the kind of serious prayer that needs to be going on. In a request of the Lord, and He's going to respond to that. He's going to fill us with the grace and the divine ability. He's going to cause us to see how that He's made all grace abound unto us. Hallelujah. So that we will have, I love that verse of scripture in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8. How He causes all grace to abound unto us so that we have all sufficiency in all things. And what is that a result of? Abandonment in your offering, abandonment in your giving. Abandonment. Not a logical conclusion of what we can afford. I mean, I hear the statistics on, and of course it comes as no surprise because of the way that people live anyways, that the vast majority of people don't even honor the Lord with 10% of that which comes into their life. Don't even honor the Lord with 10%, much less offerings. And He said, that's how You honor Me. Come honor Me with your tithes and your offerings. So we never even get to step into the grace that abounds in our life to where that God now causes all such provision so that we have so much. What are you going to do with all this? So why live in any other way but that a generosity and the provision of the riches of God? And why follow any other model? An example other than Christ Jesus, who became poor for our sake, that through His poverty we might be made rich. I'm not living another life. You can choose another life if you want, but I'm going to tell you right now, it's a demonic life. Because there's only one heaven life, there's only one Jesus life, there's only one spirit life. The other life is demonic. There's no difference. There's no other middle ground. It's a heavenly life, a Jesus life, or it's a demonic life. It's a worldly life. And we all got to deal with the challenges of it. The gut-wrenching challenges of it. Are you listening? Yeah. You got to cry out. Just, you know what you do when you got a gut-wrenching challenge? You just run, you just dive in head first. Run right for heaven. Run right for the glory. Run right, say, okay, Lord, I'm throwing in on You. Just run and tackle Him. Amen. Yeah. With total abandonment, quickly respond. You're not going to be disappointed when you get there. Because when you make the Lord the sole object of your trust, blessed is the man who doesn't walk in the counsel of the ungodly. People who are doing this, they're walking in the counsel of the ungodly in the worldly system, standing in the way of sinners. They're doing it. They're trying to be friends with the world. sit in the seat of the scornful. It's happening all the time. We're bringing up reproaches, criticism, constantly evaluating everything that's going down. That man shall be like a tree planted by the river, who shall always bring forth fruit. You'll be blessed. And then in like manner, blessed is the man who makes God the sole object of his trust. That man will be like a tree planted by the rivers, always with a leaf green. Won't know when the heat comes. Won't even be concerned about a famine, because he's living in the heavenly provision. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, my God, trust the pro. Get in on this program. If you're not in on it already, get in on it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, I'm in on this. I'm not calling those things which I possess my own. I call them belonging to the Lord to serve the interests and the purposes of the kingdom. And that's what every dollar, every penny, everything that I make with in the realms of finances, all my time, all my interest is going to go right to that. I'm going to, by the help and the grace of God, be a model of cultural change, to be a model of what it means to move forward in the kingdom of God in the midst of a great transition and crisis in the United States of America and the Western world. Now, we're just looking for some people to come follow us. Because I'm telling you right now, this is the days of great grace, where great grace is needed, great power, great authority. You can do whatever you want to do. God will give you the right to do whatever you want to do. You start reading the Bible, you're going to get stirred to be doing something different you're doing. Huh? You're going to be stirred with faith to believe for bigger things, to be used in a greater way, to participate with the kingdom of God in such a way that it's a provision not just for yourself, but for many. And not just in one locality, or not in just one nation, but many nations. Hallelujah. Because that's what we're all about. I mean, you go to pray. Go, God, give me the heathen for my inheritance and the uttermost parts of the earth for my possession. And then there's time to get up and start moving in that. So then how are you going to bring some feet to that prayer? How are you going to bring some life to that thing? How are you going to participate with God to do that in your life? What heavenly vision is going to strike you? Because is it going to happen just because you're sitting around in your room somewhere, sitting around the meeting? No, you have to rise up in a heavenly vision, begin to move in faith, to see some means, some provision, some miraculous work of grace take place that begins to move that forward. All along the way, there's going to be these temptations to build your house and live in it, to get all comfortable. The Lord had given us a provision of a large property out in Ramona, and some people came to me and they said, listen, tell you what, basically they want to give me $1 million for it 2 weeks after we bought it. I said, no, we're believing for bigger things in the kingdom. But you know what? Safety said, oh, just do that. Then later on, about 2 years later, some guys that had been the second generation developers from Coronado Island came to me and said, tell you what, we'll give you $4 or $5 million, just play it safe, you know, and just let us take over it. I said, no, I'm believing for bigger things than that. Somebody said, well, what are we doing? I'm looking for a miracle realm. Did it all work out there? No, but I didn't stop. Huh? I just went right to the next thing. In fact, I already started the next thing. And the next thing after that. To say, no, we're going after this thing big in God. People all got this mentality of their own self-interest. It ain't about your self-interest, man. It's about moving in a realm of faith where God can do such supernatural things that you go inherit the earth. Hello! It's not about a 25% return on your money. It's not about doubling your money. It's about conquering the world. It's about advancing the kingdom of God on a level where soul after soul after soul becomes precious and valuable for you and to you, and you understand how you can go and almost, as it were, buy them. Because they're 1-year-old, 2-year-old, 3-year-old kids all over India. 1-year-old, 2-year-old, 3-year-old kids all over Brazil. I broke my heart. I was in a place in Brazil. whole family of children is about six of them, all the way down to a little baby couldn't walk yet, crawling. You know where they come from? Their mothers are prostitutes. They live on the streets. The kids live on the street. The mothers are prostitutes, and the kids are abandoned. And all over the place. And you know what they do to kill the hunger? They take petroleum and they breathe it, petroleum. So that by the time they're 14 years old, they're cross-eyed and can't think. And now they just go into the sex slave, sex trafficking and stuff. Thousands upon thousands of them that can be rescued right now. It burns in my heart. All over the world. Everywhere I've gone, I look at the masses of the little children on the streets. Homeless, no food, fending for themselves. Being abused, being trafficked. In Europe, in the Ukraine, in Lithuania, right now, there's so much trafficking of children in the sex industry because they're homeless little kids. I go get them. So I'm laboring to step into a divine provision, a miraculous provision. Father sees me doing it, and he's happy about it. I'm telling the Lord sometimes, Lord, I'm completely out of streak. Yesterday I was coming home, and I was just trembling. I was shaking as I was getting ready to get on the airplane. Just so tired. I'm just, you know how you quake deep inside? You're trembling, quaking deep inside. You're just so tired. And just hear the Spirit of the Lord say, my grace is sufficient for you. I'll take care of you. Huh? Come on, man. We're breaking into realms. You don't bust into these realms. You don't break into these realms without throwing your whole being into it. Come on. There's lots of places to stop along the way. There's lots of places of security. We could have pursued our own self-interest and live high on a hill in a castle. And have a big fat bank account and sit around and just preach. Huh? Write books. I'm not interested in that. I'm interested in the millions and the billions. I'm interested in the nations. I'm interested in the things of the kingdom of God. I'm interested in occupying a place right here in the ministry of Jesus, recognizing that it's the responsibility is upon my shoulders. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah. We did this thing. I'm just telling you about it. You can't move in this realm without total abandonment and trust. Abandonment and trust isn't something you just say out of your mouth. It's something that you do with your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's not something you dream of. It's something that's birthed in your heart by the Spirit as you're crying out to God. Oh, God, use me. God, I want to do it. I'll go anywhere. I'll do anything. I'll be anything. No price is too high for me to pay. I follow you wherever you lead me. Through the garden, I go with you, oh, God. I'll go with you to Golgotha, to Calvary, to the cross. I'll go with you. I'll follow you. Where you lead me, I will follow. And then it's another thing to be in it, to be there. Praise God, one of those songs, you know. There's times I'm at crossroads, you know, in decision making, and all of a sudden some of these songs have come to me. And all of a sudden I know what to do. I know this could cost everything. I know that this is a move that goes way beyond any calculation. But I'll go with you. Huh? Come on now. Verse 33. And with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Neither was there any among them that lacked. Listen, I want to talk about real quickly. I know I don't have much time because I've already run out of time. I've got stacks of scriptures that are going off in my spirit right now that I would like to give you to lay the foundation of how to step into such great power and such great grace. To give witness of the resurrection with such authority as we see happen through the life of Peter and happen through the life of Stephen and happen through the life of James and of Philip and then later on of Paul and all the rest as well. Those were just the ones that were highlighted. The knowledge and the notion that the Lord has called us and said, we will do, he says, anyone who believes, they will do these works. And he's talking about kind and quantity. He's not talking, and he's talking about on an individual basis. He didn't say the church will. He said if anyone, he's talking to the individual, just like he was talking to those who were sitting there before him. He's talking to the individual. These works, the kind that he did and the quantity that he did, the way that he did them, from the walk, turning the water on to wine, to walking upon the water, from healing and opening up the eyes of the blind, to raising the dead to life again. And then takes it to another realm and says this would be even greater. And he gives the grace to be able to do this. He gives grace and power to be able to do this. But think about what they went through. Think about how Paul highlights this in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and talks about how great grace was upon him. Because, why? All of the persecution that he was going through, all the life-threatening things that he was going through, he had it going on. He came from the best school. He had the best opportunities that were available for men of his day in his nation. And he counted it all dung. He said, I have suffered the loss of everything, and I count it but dung. You hear me? Because people look at the great grace and they look at the great power, but they don't want to count the cost. They don't want to pay the cost. It's coming. It's coming. Revival's coming. Development is coming. Revival's here. They're alive. Development is coming. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you, Father. Thank you for helping Ellie. Strengthening Ellie. That's why we don't let her out of the high chair. That's why we don't let her out of the high chair. We just let her do that in the living room or kitchen in the high chair. You with me? Are you with me? Come back up here. I want to help you and I want to help everybody in here. That most of what she's going through right now, she could actually do in the high chair in the kitchen. But what happens is they start screaming and yelling. You let them out of the high chair. They get their way. And so they can, now their bad behavior is rewarded. Are you with me?
Yes.
Did you know that God's not going to reward bad behavior? And that if he did reward bad behavior, it's going to train you wrong and it's going to turn you into a mess and not into a blessing? Are you with me? Come on, dear people. Are you with me, Pops, over here? You can do that right there. And we did it with her just recently. And I might get an opportunity to do it with her again. Hey, I'm going to get an opportunity to do it with her again here shortly because she's going to go with me, home with me. And I just leave her right in the kitchen, in her high chair. She wants out. And she's doing that plus. And you know what's going to happen to her? You know what happens to her? Eventually she falls asleep. She wears herself completely out. And if you don't do it there, guess where it happens? Here. Hey? But I understand. I'm dealing with this kind of stuff all the time spiritually. You say, well, this is a little bit obnoxious. Yeah, it is. You let us be from my perspective. Because I'm dealing with this on a silent level, in the spiritual level, and a lot of times with people. And I want you to just let the Holy Ghost help you. I don't want anything to become too big for you. I want you to always see the provision of God. I don't want anything to overwhelm you and cause your heart to faint. I want you to know this Holy Spirit's leading you to the rock that is higher than you. And you could ask the rock for water. Water will come out. And all of a sudden, as you drink that water of provision from heaven, a river of supply of God's Holy Ghost will begin to flow through you. And out of your belly, out of the divine ability. See, God will superly abundantly supply for you all that you have need of. According to the power that is on the inside of you, according to something that resides in you. Pretty radical, eh?
Yeah.
You need to come to know and understand this power that resides, the treasure, a treasure, a treasure. But if your treasure's in earthly things, this treasure that has belonged to the realms of the Spirit will never be something that is real and valid and accessible. Hallelujah. So we just thank you, all of you, for bearing with us in our burden. As Naomi is being trained, watch what happens. Hallelujah. Watch how she develops. It ain't going to be long, dear people. And she's going to be walking around here 5 years old prophesying. Amen. And you're going to be getting blessed. I'm telling you right now. You know, I remember when she was screaming bread on the front row. And now here she is flowing in the Holy Ghost. It wasn't too long ago she was just messing up the whole service. Almost. Hallelujah. When you begin to trust God in one area, in those most important areas, you begin to trust Him in every area. And it has become, as it were, as a domino effect, the snowball effect. Hallelujah. Oh, and that thing gets so big you can't stop it. It just, trust just takes over you. Faith just takes over you. You just get drunk in the Holy Ghost. Man, you know what? You get drunk in the Holy Ghost, you just make all kinds of promises, and you're just generous, and, you know, come on. And you just know that you don't care about anything. Huh? Yeah, isn't that true? You didn't think about anything in the future. You just caught away right now in the present. And God is here, right here in the present. Praise the Lord. And with Him being so big in the present, He's going to be right there tomorrow. Amen. Bigger. Hallelujah. When you trust Him today, you can trust Him tomorrow. I was laying in my bed last night, just thinking of all the miracles of God sustaining my life and providing for me and protecting me. The Lord started flashing these things in my heart and my mind. He took me back long ago. Show me, I saved your life here. I saved your life here. Remember when this happened? I was there. I mean, one, just intense things. I'm not going to get and talk to them in the details. I'm scary and intense things. He provided. He did. Worked miracles on her back. Wow. He said, I'm the same God to you for now. I'm the same God to you right now. I felt so exhausted last night at midnight. I'm like, I was too exhausted to go to sleep. I said, Lord, I'm too exhausted to go to sleep. I can't sleep. And that's when He began to walk me through this. I'm God. I'm your God. Come on, people. I'd love to take you through. Can I take you through 1 Corinthians chapter 12? Now, can you look at all? You can go and study. Just look at what all Paul went through. Look at what all they went through. Look at what they were willing to go through. They didn't have to go through that. They were burning with the fire of the Word of God. They were burning with the purposes of the kingdom. We're almost there. We're almost there. We're just about to have a breakthrough. We're almost there. Thank you, Jesus. Everybody stand with me, will you? Stand. Dear people, I want to tell you tonight, the Lord's not put any limits on you. You put limits on Him. You put limits on yourself. You say, where do I put limits on Him? Where do I put limits on myself? By not trusting Him. Where have I not trusted Him? Every place that you're not willing to walk with Him in total abandonment. Every place where you need to take care of yourself, where you're not willing to step out in faith. Tonight, we're here in the presence of the Lord with a grace and a provision from heaven to change the dynamics of the way that you've lived, to change the dynamics of the way that you've thought, to change the dynamics of the way that you've reacted to the circumstances around you that have kept you from moving forward in God. Tonight, God is here with an authority to begin to cause you to move in a greater dimension of power, in a greater dimension of grace, a greater dimension of total abandonment, to go and do the things which He's assigned for us to do, to have a heavenly vision from this day forward, to live for a heavenly division, to have your whole life deposited in the kingdom of God. You have this crazy belief that they're going to have some kind of retirement plan. You're going to be too old and stale to do anything with it. I heard that they're going to move the retirement age up to 68. Because there's not enough funds to take care of everybody's Social Security thing. Come on, people. I'm just trying to convince you that God's going to take better care of you than that. Give me a break. Father's going to take better care of you than that. Come on, dear people. Come on. Come on. How is it that you're going to make this transition from this life to the next life anyways? Iprasarabakita. Iprasatarabakita. Iprasatarabakita rasarobo. Iprabasatarebengeshte. How are you going to make the transition from this life to the next life? I see you on the foreign field preaching the gospel, reaching the lost. I see you being used by the Spirit of the Lord to bring revival and awakening to people groups that have never been ministered to before. I see you moving in faith to generate great provision and great wealth for your whole purpose. Is due to do nothing but to present yourself a living sacrifice to just generate an unlimited supply of resources to those who are running with the heavenly vision. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lo robo risteya. Lo robo risteya ria. Lo robo risti rimos. Ha ha ha. Ha ha ha. Hallelujah. You know, I love it when Allie begins to flow in the Holy Ghost and minister to the people, but tonight she's doing some very effective ministry. I'm just so proud of her. This is effective ministry because I'm going to tell you right now, when you're willing to lay hold on the things that challenge you like this and stay with it until the thing is defeated. Out of that, God begins to bring forth glorious fruit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just lift your hands towards heaven with me.